We heard some fascinating data this morning about trade costs in Africa and how trade costs are so much higher for LDCs, how trade costs are so much higher for low-income countries as well as LDCs, and how trade costs are particularly high for landlocked LDCs, etc. All this to make the point that we need to understand how trade works practically so that we can try to address those costs. There is no doubt about the importance of trade in sustainable economic development for everybody. So we're very appreciative of all these efforts to try to understand in these terms how to advance the political agenda forward. But it's also important to look down to the ground and to look at actual cases and see what really happens, which I think was the raison d'etre for this session, to take an actual case study, to look at the sourcing of flowers, cut flowers from Kenya, and to understand exactly what is their experience from the beginning of the supply chain to the market. There's been a great deal of talk of late as well of supply chains, global value chains, regional value chains, and these have given us a good framework for understanding and unpacking the whole process of the production and supply of goods that are traded externally and try to understand where costs are incurred all along the way, but more than costs, also trying to understand how sustainable development impacts are occurred all along the way. What does it do for employment? What do we do for environment? What do we do on education? What do we do in all these different contexts as we produce these products and bring them to market? Now, as I said, the unfortunate thing is that our main speaker, Jane Ngigi, is not here yet. So perhaps what I might do is start by introducing our other two speakers and perhaps ask them to give a few comments on this range of subjects. Our speaker at the end there is Dr. Pierre Groning, who is the head of international trade policy at the Foreign Trade Association, which is an enormous business association of European and international companies that promote the values, as I said earlier, of both free trade and sustainable supply chains. It is a huge association, and I think he has spent a career in trying to understand these linkages and promote the policy interface. Dr. Karl Breuner, on his left, is a Deputy Director General of the World Trade Organization and also has had a long career in economic policy and most recently was, before joining the WTO, was the Director General for External Economic Policy for the German government. Is that correct? So he has an extensive experience of how international trade policy works and how it can be used and developed to support the development of LDCs and LICs. Right, well with that, I think perhaps the best way to start is to think, I'm just trying to reconfigure here on the hoof kind of thing. I wonder if we start with Karl, perhaps, and talk a little bit about the relationship between international trade policy and agreement and where we are and how things can move forward in promoting these kinds of exports and sustainability in these exports. Thank you.
Okay, I thank you very much. I have come here with great expectations because I'm very keen on hearing Jane. Jane, as we learned, is the lady who is doing the business down to the ground. She has the real experience, and I was hoping to learn through her experience. I'm sure this is going to happen this afternoon. My approach is a bit more theoretical. I come from the wider perspective of the WTO, although I as a private consumer, have some experience as well. My sister is a horticulture engineer. She tries to beautify her surroundings all the time, and I'm sure she uses a lot of your products. In my business ventures, formerly in the Ministry of Economics, I only had to do with Colombia and their carnations, but I'm very pleased to learn that you have the full variety here. We are looking at global value chains. We in the WTO have done a lot of research on the global value chains, and our last World Trade Report in 2014, this is one of our flagship publications, was actually devoted to the global value chains. We detect that the global value chain offers a unique chance for people to participate in global trade. I must say I never looked at flowers or agricultural products in the context of global value chains. For me, it was always linked to industrial products, to technical products. This is why I'm particularly keen to hear to listen to Jane afterwards.
It's maybe not that much from Africa, because so far our examples are more oriented towards Asia. And then I become more local into the sourcing activities of my members in East Africa. The FTA represents about, it was mentioned earlier, 1,700 retailers from Europe, but also brand companies and importers. These tend to be SMEs, so small and medium-sized companies. The total volume of our business is around 800 billion euros, so I would say quite substantial. To give you some concrete examples, we have members like hypermarket and supermarket chain Carrefour, Tesco from the UK. We have garment companies such as Adidas, Puma, Zara. So a wide range of companies, mostly from Europe, but we tend to go more international in the recent days. In the context of international trade, of course, and resourcing globally, it's not a new understanding that in certain countries, international laws, are not protected in a way that you could fully trust the enforcement bodies. So you could say that protecting workers' rights is not always done appropriately. And therefore, more than 10 years ago, in 2003, my association started the Business Social Compliance Initiative, BSCI, which is one of the largest sustainability programs by the retail sector in the world, and I think by the business as such in the world. The idea is pretty simple. We want to improve the social and labor conditions along the supply chain. And therefore, my association, doesn't only stand for free trade, but also for sustainable trade very much. The initiative is working to support buying companies to integrate the BCI code of conduct, that's kind of our fundamental law, into the heart of the business practices. And the approach is simple. We run audits, but we do not stop with running audits, because we know that an audit is a punctual event and it needs more to really make a supply chain sustainable. Therefore, we also promote on capacity building, so that's giving webinars, seminars, physical training at all levels of the supply chain, again, on the farm, in the factory, but also to our members that import and later on the products. And we also engaged in stakeholder relations, which we think is essential to bring together the different stakeholders in countries. And again, I think we have done a pretty good job in many Asian countries in that respect. So what is the role of international trade and the link of trade, the impact of it when it comes to importing fast-moving consumer goods? I think if you look at the recent history, the last three decades, I think the evidence is pretty much there that global economy has flourished, and that is very much driven by what you would call globalization, the opening of trade, globalization of trade flows. The walls are a rapid transformation of formerly closed and isolated economies, China, Vietnam, in previous times also Korea, South Korea, of course, to become economic powerhouses and now challenging domination of the Western industrialized countries from Europe and America for a couple of years. And I think that's a fantastic change that we saw over time. But it's true that governments need to have a clear plan to promote these ideas. And I think you're all aware that free trade is one element of that, but without good governance, you cannot achieve substantial growth and creating high-level jobs. So I think these have to go together. And if I may take an example, which is not from Africa, but from Asia, Bangladesh, we have issued a publication a couple of weeks ago that is rather short. It's a leaflet, but very graphic, and showing that Bangladesh is a success case. And I say that despite the tragic incident of Rana Plaza 2.5 years ago and other incidents that might occur and have occurred in the past. But nevertheless, if you see where Bangladesh started in 1971 when they became independent, the early 90s when they started a reform program. They have reduced significantly the share of poor people. I have it here since 1992, the poverty rate has dropped from 57% to 25% in 2014, coupled with increased life expectancy, literacy rate, and per capita food intake. So I think, in that respect, very much a significant move that is mainly driven, and that was my point, mainly driven by the ready-made garment sector, which is today representing 81% of the exports of that country. So, of course, you can criticize you business makers from Europe selling garments from Bangladesh in your shops, take advantage of the situation in the country. But at the same time, you should not forget that that country has massively profited from that. Many challenges are still ahead, and I think we are the first to embark on the road of getting away and getting rid of these obstacles. But I think that the message is clear: by becoming part of the sustainable of the global value chains, and the WTO Director General Kalmona mentioned that you can build up a certain capacities, and it can go relatively quick, because I think a decade or two is not too much expected. And in that respect, I think Kenya, and I hope we'll hear in a couple of minutes more from Jane, might become another success story, if you say as you want, and that could be driven notably by the export of flowers. Maybe now looking at East Africa, because I know that most of you are not interested that much by Asia and Bangladesh, but maybe more by the local situation. To be very honest, this region remains to be yet fully discovered and embraced by, let's say, the retail sector and the import sector that I represent. Across the globe, we have, I think, an impressive amount of 30,000 factories and farms in our BSCI system. That's the system I mentioned earlier that is promoting certain labor standards across the supply chain, so 30,000 factories and farms. Until recently, we had none from Eastern Africa. And Eastern Africa, for me, according to our statistics, is Ethiopia, Kenya, and Tanzania. So none until 2010. And since then, we see a sharp increase, of course, from a very low point. And today, we have 34 producers from these three countries in our system. So still only 0.1% of the total volume, so tiny. But again, the tendency is positive. Members are importing mainly from East Africa fresh fruit, vegetables, processed food, coffee, flowers, not to forget, obviously. So we are here more in the, let's say, in the primary sector. But we see also more and more members looking into textiles. You know of some of the cases of big European brand companies looking more into Ethiopia these days. H&M is one example that has also been mentioned by press articles. So something that we can tell you members are interested in. And we have recently asked our members to tell us which are the hotspots of the future when it comes to sourcing of textiles. So again, I'm in the textile sector here. And 8% mentioned Ethiopia as one of the destinations of the future to make investment and to source from. So again, there are other regions that are far ahead of East Africa, still China, still Bangladesh, Turkey, Eastern Europe quite a lot in our internal surveys and statistics. But for the first time, we have here an East African country that is among the top 10. So I think that's very encouraging and something that we can build on. Especially today, I think there's a real window of opportunity for East Africa that needs to be developed. Since we see that in many Asian markets, wages are rising, and you know that the textile sector, but also most commodity sectors are low wages sectors, and therefore, of course, you calculate on tiny margins. And in that respect, I think Africa and East Africa has a huge potential in that context to play. And I think there is real possibility to attract labor-intensive industries, and that is not, again, to put the finger on that being like negative. Again, I think if you take again the example of Bangladesh or China or other countries, they have started from that. So I think you have to start somewhere, and if labor-intensive industries, textiles and so on, is a good starting point, then please develop. Of course, at the same time, the assessment of the situation is not completely positive, rosy, or you could even say bleak to some extent, because we see a lot of obstacles still hampering the accession of East Africa to the global markets. You are, I think, all familiar with these, transport infrastructure, unskilled labor, challenging investment climate, legal incertitude for foreign companies. I think so, regional integration that is not fully developed. So I think many of these issues that have been discussed also over the last two or three days here in that circle. So I think a lot of work ahead, but there is potential. So I want to keep that positive note. So by maybe saying some concluding remarks, I would like to stress that the European retail sector is a development that, again, I think in Europe we take very serious, but not only in Europe, but I think very much also in Africa. So I think we have to live that, and we have to walk the talk, and not see sustainability as a pure PR mechanism. So I think we are far ahead of that. Secondly, developing and emerging markets gain from participating in global value chains. I mean, that might be a very evident statement, but again, sometimes we are confronted with these kind of dubious argumentations, so again, to stress that. And we have many striking examples from Asia about countries that have succeeded in progressing in the development because of producing for the European mass consumer markets. This is a bit less the case for Africa, but as I mentioned, our aim now is to increase the share of East Africa, of Kenya, in global value chains, to also create, if you want to say so, African success stories. And thirdly, in my view, the strongest promoters of economic growth, I mentioned before, are free trade and good governance combined. And in that respect, I think the African political and business leaders should not wait for the world to change, because that's something I hear from time to time, and maybe too often, that you, Europe, you, US, have to change to allow us to be part of this global value chains. I think if China would have waited for that, I think they would still be in the Mao area. So do not wait for the world to change. Take dynamic and active policies to be part of that success story of trade liberalization and global value chains. And I mentioned today there's a major opportunity to attract investment and to lift Africa to its rightful place in global business. And I think it's very much a shared responsibility, and again, the retail sector would like to be part of that success story.
Thank you.
That's it. Thank you very much for that sort of general overview. I have a question for each of you, so perhaps I'll start with Pierre, since you're on a roll there. I think it's absolutely laudable, the BSCI, the notion of trying to integrate sustainability into the purchase system, into the supply chain. But of course we've heard the concerns in the past about sustainability, A, adding costs, and how does this fit in a continent that is already experiencing higher trade costs than other places? And secondly is, how can we ensure ease of access to the markets, that these kinds of standards do not become non-tariff barriers? Mm-hmm. How do you work with, or how do you and your members work with their suppliers in Africa to ensure that they can join these standards, that they can join the sustainability movement, but without being overwhelmed by the cost impacts and access impacts?
Well, it's very concrete and very live question, in the sense that I just got to answer to a similar question on Monday when I visited a Kenyan producer of fruits and vegetables, which will become part of our system in the next year. And they had exactly the same concern. So I have to run these audits now. This is cost for me. This is time. I have to get used to it. What is my added value? And of course, the response is at the beginning, there is no real added value for you, except that your business partner is imposing this on you. So you have not a real choice. I mean, you can say, I don't do this, but you might lose then your business partner from Europe, the importer, or the supermarket chain. But then there's, I think, a second perspective, and maybe the more long-term consideration, that by doing this, you raise your own standards. You become maybe, you qualify yourself maybe to extend your business network to more companies that are interested by high-value goods, and goods that are produced under conditions, I think, where we can have our children eating that without having a bad conscience. And as I mentioned before, Africa, I think, is in the right situation now to not only access the European market, but maybe integrate already the lessons from the history and avoid mistakes from the past. I think we have had maybe a decade or two in the 80s, maybe in the 90s, until the late 90s, beginning of 2000, maybe where I think these standards maybe did not really interest the buyers, the consumers, the producers, and I think we lost a lot of time in that respect, and some countries more in Asia still suffer from that situation, that the foundation was not put rightly. And I think Africa can now maybe, say with a fresh start, profit from that and already integrate these mistakes and avoid them, obviously, from the past. So I think that company, for example, here, they have a packaging center close to the airport, fantastic products, fresh products from the field to the European supermarket within 2 days, also showing that there is infrastructure available that allows for these kind of services to be provided. And I think we need more of these positive examples. And when I went to see them on Monday, they had read our documents. They had lots of questions. They had understood the system and what we wanted from them. I think so they were far ahead of many of the other producers and farms that we have in our system that start and start really at point zero. So I found it very encouraging, and think that for me was like a real positive story already that I take from.
Thank you. Well, that's very clear on the ground we're seeing positive action. Mm-hmm. But Carl, over to you. Let's think of the policy implications here. These value chains are increasingly sort of, we see the multiple things in the textile chain. You know, there's the cotton's got to be grown somewhere, the cloth has to be made over there, the design gets there, this gets done there, that gets done there. Even in respect of flowers, the supply chain is not quite that simple. There's the issue of the seeds and the cuttings, there's the issue of the research and development, there's the issue of the packaging, there's the issue of the logistics of transport, plus, of course, the flowers themselves. How do we see the policy framework, A, of the Trade Facilitation Agreement and of other policy developments facilitating the smooth development of these value chains?
Okay, we are just currently in this round discussing rules of origin. I mean, you are referring to the complexity of how the final product is set together. And we have in the past experienced situations where those whom we wanted to benefit from certain preferential agreements, like the European Union has got this what we call everything but arms, so you can get anything into the European Union without any duties, without any quotas, if you come from a developing country. But then the product must be from the developing country. Therefore is the question for the rules of origin. Is a product coming from Kenya when most of the ingredients for the product are bought outside Kenya? I have this example of, it's again from Asia, where in Bangladesh a man produces in his factory a t-shirt for Ferrari. For each Formula One race, Ferrari wants another t-shirt, complicated design with all sorts of niceties in it, reflectors and glitter threads and all sorts of things, and this guy has to buy much of it outside Bangladesh. And for me this is a very nice example. He needs trade facilitation to get things into Bangladesh. Then he produces the very nice t-shirt and it has to go out to Bahrain or to Silverstone. He needs trade facilitation again to get it out of Bangladesh, to get it into the UK. And if you look at the value of his t-shirt, most of what he has sourced comes from outside Bangladesh. It is expensive, and what he adds is practically sewing it together. And there are rules of origin which would not allow this t-shirt to be called originating from Bangladesh. And what we have are just about to agree is that if the product is produced in a developing country, then 75% of its value may come from outside the LDC. So only 25% of the value added must come from inside the LDC. And I think this is making life easier for certain producers, because some of them say the rules of origin are so complicated that I am not making use of the preferential rules. I just go through the ordinary procedure. So we are here trying to facilitate the situation.
That's very useful. Thank you. Sorry, I might as well take a question or two from the floor. Yes, please go ahead.
The change in climate. And the result is that a seedling, as an example, which is a 100% component, may very well no longer be able to be grown in the European Union and may be grown somewhere else instead. Does this agreement cover the fact that in agriculture, a seedling is effectively the 100% component, and if that comes from somewhere outside the low economically developed country, will that negatively impact their ability to call it a Kenyan product?
I think that's getting sort of a little bit into the specifics of the issue. And it's this understanding of where the value is accumulated. Now, I have to say that in my experience of cut flowers, which is quite old, when I was looking at investing in flowers, it was really all about cuttings. It wasn't about seedlings. So I think it's really more commonly, in my agricultural experience as well, seeds that may come from somewhere else. So I think, I don't know how you would look at what component the seed is of the final agricultural product. I just don't have the data to answer that question. And I think
I think it should not really become a problem, because now various countries have different rules of how to establish origin. But I think what we're working at this point in time is that the rules should be such that either you look at the value or you look at the last stage of transformation. And if this last stage of transformation is taking place in Kenya, it's Kenyan origin.
And I would, of course, argue that labor costs are a significant component. Yeah. I mean, these are very labor-intensive industries, cut flowers and other agricultural products. So I think you've got a good chance that a significant portion of the value is accumulated in country. It'll be interesting to see how these value chains develop as regional integration improves as well, and what that means for rules of origin. I'm sorry, you have a question, and then over here. So first that lady, and then here, please, and then at the back.
Hello, my name is Mumbi from Kenya. My question is about the coffee. You find we grow coffee in Kenya, and when you go to Europe, you find coffee written European coffee, American coffee. But that's the original is from Kenya. So what do you do about that? Because Kenya, we are the ones who are producing. When it goes out there, they market like from another country. Thank you.
Okay, we'll gather these questions together. Over here, please. And then at the back. What's that? This chap here, please, and we'll go there, and then we'll go to
my name is Benson Kathuri from East Africa Trade Review. I have two questions. One is on tariff escalation. Yeah. We produce, we export mostly primary commodities, but anytime we try to add a small value, tariff goes up. The issue is, who is responsible for that escalation? Or what is the hidden hand? Because I believe probably the governments have good intentions, but probably the private sector might be the hidden hand. Okay. And is that not NTBs?
Okay.
The second one is on standards. I think this one is for the FTA, the standards. I believe there is no problem with the standards. Some of them, most producers can't comply. A good example is the Eurogap. It was actually, it came in, farmers or producers complied. But the problem is the multiplication of those standards. Everybody is coming up with their own standards. Those, the supermarket chains, come up with their own standards. ISO has its own standards. Why can't they have one common standard? If we are going for food safety, why don't we go for ISO 2000 and use it across board? But now you find the standards are different in UK, different in France, different in Germany. Those ones are actually causing a lot of confusion and actually edging out some of the producers because they are expensive.
Thank you. Sorry, we need to keep our questions brief, please. And I think we've got that one done.
Also to say that Jane should be here in a couple of seconds now.
Yeah. So let's quickly try and very brief questions, please. One here and one at the back.
Thank you. My name is Thabo Chauke. I'm from South Africa. My question is similar to what the gentleman posed. And it's related to this notion of proliferation of private standards.
Understood.
And under the name of protecting the climate or you know, or labor issues.
Okay, thank you. Question from the back, please.
Thank you. I think I may stand up because I'm a little bit far from. I'm putting this question to. And my name is Iregi Wanjohi. I'm in the ICT. ICT field in Kenya. I'm going to put this question to Carl and Mr. Pierre. The world is, the population of the world, 50% is living on of $1 a day. And the other half is less than $1. We are not doing very well in the trade because the same 50% and the other 49%, whatever, it's they are your customers. How can we try to improve the globalization of everything so that everybody can come up and not have people living in below poverty levels? Because basically that's where we are. And I don't think this trend can continue like this the next 50 years. We are going to be a totally obsolete civilization.
Okay, thank you very much. Right. Cole, would you please like to take on first the tariff escalation issue and perhaps also the coffee?
Yeah.
And then we'll get on to standards and inequities.
Tariff escalation is a sin. It's a sin. It's immoral. I've no doubt about it. Tariff escalation should be abolished. We should give people who produce the raw material a chance to add the value. And we shouldn't be protecting northern producers with tariff escalation. Tariff escalation is still happening. It's no good.
Okay.
And we are working for the abolition of tariff escalation, but it's the member states who have to take the decision. And we are trying in the multilateral context to get market opening also by abolishing tariff escalation. Coffee from Kenya. I come from Germany. Most of the coffee in Germany is, I was told, from Vietnam. And then you add some elements of coffee from elsewhere to always show the same standard. You only have to tell the consumer where the product comes from. When you tell where the product comes from, it should be honest. You must not deceive the producer, the consumer. So this is, in the way I understand it, not a question of a labeling requirement, but of a requirement to be fair and honest in the information to the consumer. The standards is a real problem. When I was still working for the Ministry of Economics, we once tried an event between Germany and France on having an electric car move in Strasbourg from one side of the border to the other, but we couldn't agree on the proper configuration of the plug. So the event couldn't take place. And when we are now negotiating, we, the European Union, with the Americans, it's all over standards. And the standards is a real issue because you have those many private standard-setting associations and everybody has an interest in maintaining its standard. But Benson's name, right? If you comply with a standard of one European member state, you can have your products in all over the European Union. So this should simplify the issue. Thank you.
But Pierre, perhaps from you as a sort of a private sector association,
can answer to this question about the proliferation of standards. What are your members doing, and how are they collaborating to improve harmonization of standards?
No, thank you for the question, because it's of real urgency to find proper solutions to that, because we see it ourselves very much, that there is a mushrooming of private standards, that there is legal pressure more and more in Europe by certain member states, but also at European level, that's Jane Gige, that lead to the situation that producers have to comply with a standard for Europe, maybe for different member states, different standards, different sectors of business, different standards in the US and Canada, Japan. So it's true, it's a big mess, you can say that, and there is a real fatigue among producers to run audits to comply with the different standards. And we are the first ones as an association that promotes free trade to get rid of that. But it's also true at the same time that a program like mine, the BSCI, is in competition, you could say, with other programs. We have one in the UK, we have several in the US, only for my sector, and then all the other sectors have other hundreds and thousands of standards. And there is a real willingness these days to try to bridge them, not maybe to merge that much. Also, that happened. For example, now we are merging with the French standard, Clause Initiative Sociale. But competition remains, but at least to narrow the gap and maybe come to a way that we could mutually accept standards, audit reports. For example, we are now in negotiation with Disney, the big entertainment company from the US, that they would allow my BSCI standard and I would allow their Disney standard. So I think that's the way forward. It's a long-term process, but at least we have this objective. Maybe just one sentence on does trade work or not. I think we have, asked by the gentleman from the last row, I think we have to have a very long-term approach. I mean, again, I brought the example of Bangladesh, but we could also talk about Vietnam and China and other countries. They started at one point to become part of the global value chain of global industries, and they managed after a couple of years, decades, to reach a certain level of development. So it's very much about managing our expectations, and I know it's not an easy answer if a country is in a very unfavorable situation, that you tell them it will take you one decade or two, but I think that's unfortunately the reality.
Yeah. I think though there's a very real consensus internationally now to understand that trade on its own and economic development on its own, however important and essential they are not sufficient just as they are. And we saw in New York in September a real multilateral consensus around the adoption of the Sustainable Development Goals, understanding through Goal 17 that trade has an important role to play in delivering these sustainable development goals, including addressing the issues of global inequity. I think, as Pierre says, this is a long-term goal. It's not Rome built in a day, but I do see this year that there's a growing international consensus around trying to ensure that trade and economic trade leads to inclusive economic growth, which delivers sustainable development benefits for all. We're delighted now that our keynote speaker, Jane Ngigi, has arrived, and I think this will enable us to take the sort of policy-focused discussion we've had and general discussion we've had right down to the ground in understanding a very important sector here in Kenya and how it's worked on the ground. Jane, could I ask you, in fact, to introduce yourself as the Kenya Flower Council and your work and what you do and who you represent? Yes, indeed. The video is ready and correct. Would you care to introduce yourself first? Well, the flowers are there because she's the flowers. Shall we move the flowers out of the way? Yes, of course. Pass the
flower.
If you pass the flower, okay.
There I am.
Is that good?
Thank you very much. And I must, first of all, apologize for coming in so late. I had no idea how difficult it was to come into Nairobi. I've had to do quite a bit of legwork, and I wasn't prepared for that. And I had to abandon my vehicle at some point and just do the legwork. But having said that, my name is Jane Gige. I am the chief executive of the Kenya Flower Council. and recently taken on board the responsibility for the Kenya Horticulture Council as well. And what I'd like to share with you this afternoon is an idea of how the use and adoption of standards in a global value chain such as the flowers can actually facilitate trade, because you need to speak a common language with many different markets. And in our case, right now we are looking at about 50 different destinations. And you must find a language that is consistent, a language that sends the message that you need projected to those markets. And from where I sit, the one way that I found this effective is to use standards. However, like I found Pierre explaining, standards themselves can be quite a hurdle, can be very often a non-trade barrier to trade, non-tariff trade barrier to trade, because different markets will require that you have different, you meet different requirements. And some of these requirements are not always the kind of requirements that business expects to have to comply to. I'd like to begin by just showing you one of our latest developments, and that is in the development of a national standard. We've had an industry standard limited to the members of the Kenya Flower Council, which is the largest organization representing growers. But we also realized that it didn't matter how hard we worked as an association, we had to ensure that everybody in the flower industry follows, like I said, a standard that everybody can adhere to. And the standard I'm referring to here is now a national standard adopted by government, and we're currently in the phase of trying to implement it effectively. And perhaps if I can get that on the screen.
Could we just have some audiovisual assistance, please?
Oh,
Could we have some AV assistance, please, to get the video up?
I think we don't have it.
You sent it together.
Do we have it or not? That's PowerPoint.
Well, that's the program. It's a panelist.
If you click on, then we have your presentation. I think we.
That's my presentation.
I'm not sure we will have the video.
That's
actually
the presentation, but I don't know about the video then.
I'm not sure if we have it. I understood
okay.
That.
But that's a pity. That's a real pity. But we can go through the PowerPoint, and especially because time is also not on our side. So this is just to explain who the Kenya Flower Council is, and to let you know that you know, our main business here is to facilitate business. And as I mentioned, we are the main body that represents the flower industry. This is just to show you how the industry has been performing over the years since 2010 to 2014. And you can see that out of the horticultural products, flowers are significant, and then there are the other products. Flowers are significant because we are raking in about 56.4 billion Kenya shillings, at least in 2014, employing about 100,000 people directly. And indirectly, like myself, another 500,000 people. And if you imagine that we all support at least 3 people, that's 2 million livelihoods that rely on this industry. So, and at the same time, we have to access the distant markets. You know, we're dealing with distant markets, and the only way we can communicate with these markets is standards. So if they want you to comply, say, with global gap, which a lot of people are familiar with, they just want to see the standard global gap and to see that you comply to that. And that goes for all these products. And it doesn't really matter how well one sector does. All the exports, all the horticultural exports, need to comply to these standards if indeed Kenya as a country is to have a valued presence in the marketplace. In the case of the Kenya Flower Council, this is a certificate we issue to growers who are compliant to the industry standard. And you will notice that we are an accredited certification body. You can see the insignia of SANAS there, and our number is C14. I know that off head. And with this certificate, you should be able to get into a lot of markets. And why do I say that? Because if you look at this graph, and you will see where it says KFC stroke SG, and BOPP growers. These are the standards that we have to comply to. And if you look at the element of environment, just the green bar, and you compare the KFC bar and to the one on BOPP, you can see that the KFC is much higher. If you look at the next one, FT is another standard, hired labor. The KFC, again, looking at the social bar, again, we are higher than that particular standard. And I'd like you to keep that in mind and see that in this case, we are looking at BSSI. I don't know where that blue line has come from, but try and ignore it for now. Again, if you look at BSCI and KFC, and you're looking at the element of social, again, you see that the KFC is higher. If you look at Floridi, which is out of South America, a similar case, that the KFC standard tends to be higher than most. And, you know, the story goes on with all the other standards. In other words, we're saying that we've gone through an international benchmarking process to all of these standards, an independent benchmarking process, through an organization, the Flower Sustainability Initiative in Europe, and working with ITC, and put our own standard against all these other market standards. And we're very proud of the fact that we have fared very well and actually done quite well in compared to the other standards. And this was our one way of saying to the market that, hey, we produce flowers in Kenya, we're a sustainable and a responsible source of flowers, and the only way we could justify that was going through an exercise like this compared to other standards. As I was saying, these are some of the areas that we cover and in our standard, the social accountability issues, the key ones being freedom of association, gender and equity committees we have on the farms, child labor is a lot, equal pay. And in terms of environment, we ensure that our growers do their business while protecting the environment and managing their resources efficiently. We do contribute to initiatives of tree cover in the country. And actually, we have what you call an industry virtual forest. That means that an individual farm out of those 94 may not make a significant contribution in terms of the trees planted on the ground, but collectively, the 94 farms, all the trees planted there, make quite a forest. And that's what we refer to as an industry virtual forest for carbon sinking, or for carbon neutralization. Are we inclusive in terms of our business? We work very, very closely with the gentlemen and ladies that you will see selling flowers on the streets of Nairobi. They have an association of about 100 of those, and they're members of the Kenya Flower Council. And these are the men and women who are able to put the flowers in the face of Kenyans, but also in the face of our visitors. These are probably done by somebody from that association. And we support them through all sorts of initiatives like campaigns or Valentine's. This town will be red and white during the next Valentine's. And we've managed to bring them on board and include them in our business. In terms of small-scale growers, again, I'm currently working with about 150 of those, and they work mainly with the summer flowers or the fillers, the non-rose products. And we've been working with these ones also to train them and also to bring them into the certification scheme so that we're not just talking about the main rose producers. And especially now when more and more products going into the market are actually finished products ready for the shelves. You have bouquets, they're ready for Tesco's, they're ready for Marks and Spencer, so they do need to be roses. Just like you see in this arrangement, they do need to be roses compounded with other products. And most of our challenges really is that we're dealing with the sophisticated in terms of demand and very discerning distant markets. And then we have to deal, like Piero was saying, with multiple market standards. And the cost of compliance and audits is not cheap at all. And therefore, the fact that these can actually become, they have a high potential of becoming non-tariff trade barriers. In terms of what we're now looking at is how can we improve productivity throughout the value chain all the way to the market. and we really need to focus on the logistics and post-harvest handling so that the A quality of the flour that leaves the country is also the A quality that reaches the consumer. Collaboration is extremely important, and of course, looking at new and emerging markets, and of course, as I said, to enhance that the language of communication through the use of standards. Thank you very much.
Cool. Thank you very much, Jane, for that lightning presentation. I think given that we're supposed to be ending in 3 minutes, we will sacrifice the non-existent video for the sake of some questions, please. So let us please just keep your questions extremely brief, because we do only have a few minutes. But I think this has been absolutely fantastic, because the actual experience on the ground very much mirrors the kind of discussion we had before you got here. So now we see we are not worrying about nothing. A question at the back there, please.
Thank you for that. And kudos to Kenya Flour Council for the standard that you displayed, you talked about, and also for the benchmarking that was done. You mentioned in the very beginning and again towards the end that the importance of standards is so that it is a language that can be understood. You said that Kenya exports to 50 different destinations.
50.
So, 50, wasn't it 50?
50.
Yeah. So my question is, what is the plan to showcase, to market this particular standard so that it can be accepted in these 50 different destinations? And can it also then take over and be just the one that would be required for Kenyan flowers, as opposed to the multiple certifications that we currently have?
Thank you. Always the challenge. Another question here, please. Come forward, please. Okay. This lady here.
Thank you very much. Now, one appreciated the presentation. It was useful to get the earlier background. Mine is a very specific question, the practicalities here. And that is, you know, in South Africa, for example, we find that it's not as simple as growing it. It's not as simple as the standards getting there. It's very challenging small parts of the value chain. Getting it to the airport at the right temperature. And I don't know, you know, just how one deals with that, because we have a lot of women who are dealing with the flowers, and then we've got some men involved in the marketing. But nobody seems to get the temperature right. And it would appear to me as if one needs some other expert here, not a marketing person, not an ordinary agricultural person, but somebody who knows how to transport flowers. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Two at the back, please.
Thank you for the presentation. I just wanted to touch on the challenges and ask, in terms of, because you mentioned the issue of cost, and indeed it's very expensive for the farmers to be able to, not only just for the flower growers, but also for the farmers to be able to ensure that they manage, or they're able to manage those costs. I wonder how you or the government is actually supporting those farmers, because that's one of the biggest complaints that you're going to meet, that it's too expensive to ensure that they meet all those standards. Thank you.
And there was another question at the back, and then a last question in front of you, please.
A related question. Are there standards which you've had to comply with in Kenya that you think were kind of incorrect, or they're put out, like, where they're kind of too extreme for you? I'm working in Rwanda at the moment, and an organization we partner with was doing some work on the tea sector, and Rwanda's had a lot of trouble exporting tea because the ILO have accused them of child labor. But often it's not sort of traditional child labor. It's people working at home, you know, people doing traditional activities like cutting grass with machetes and so on. Okay. So have you run into problems like that where the standards were just not appropriate?
Thank you. And then a final question in front of you, please.
Well, thank you. Peter Kierkegaard from the Confederation of Danish Industry.
I'm not speaking on behalf of the Confederation of Danish Industry, but as a European consumer, and basically just a comment on the coffee issue before, because as a European and a Danish consumer, I would never buy American coffee. I go for the Kenyan coffee because I know it's a good value and a good brand. And this is maybe just an encouragement to maybe say that maybe Africa needs to brand its products in a better way, in a better fashion to European consumers.
Right, thank you. So we've had an interesting batch of questions there. Mm-hmm. And I'm afraid, Jane, you're for it because the rest have been grilled earlier. So we've heard about the prospects of, what are the prospects for your standard becoming a common standard, helping with harmonization? And have you seen any kind of take up of your standard on the part of the buyers? There's been further concern around standards, is the costs for the farmers of complying with the standards. How do you see this progressing? An interesting question on the appropriateness of standards, and have you had any experience of inappropriate standards or standards you really didn't feel that were relevant to your industry and appropriate? And that's the sort of group of standards questions. Then we had a question, a value chain question, really. And we see this coming up in other value chain work as well, is how are the logistical challenges dealt with, because that's such an important part for your business. And finally, how are we succeeding in branding Kenyan flowers?
Okay. Starting off with the harmonization of standards, I think the lesson we have learned there is that we can now step out into the market and promote our standard. And you know very well how difficult it is to enter into the market on a promotional arena or the marketing arena, and we needed a tool that we could peg ourselves or peg our industry on, and now we have a very good tool. Previous to that, we just had to, you know, just talk about it, and now we have a tool that says we are among the international standards and we compare very well with those standards, so can we come into your market? So we'll continue looking out for harmonization indeed, but also mutual recognition. So that if you have a KFC certificate of compliance, you do not need a Global Gap, a BSIC, CI, or a BOPP. You know, that should be internationally recognized. And this is one area that we think working with WTO would help. Yes, WTO works with public standards, but I think some guidelines or some principles in terms of how to deal with private sector standards becoming non-tariff trade barriers is an area that we could use the expertise within WTO to help us come up with some sort of guidelines, international guidelines. In terms of the cost of that compliance, how the industry in Kenya has dealt with that is recognizing that the small-scale grower, the big-scale grower, are all going into the same market. They have realized that they've had to share some of the responsibilities where the big companies support the smaller companies through the association, where their subscriptions are all pegged on the tonnage. So if you're a small-scale grower and you're exporting just 1 ton, you pay just the same amount as a guy with 1,000 tons for per ton. So the subscription is per ton, and it doesn't matter how small you are or how big you are. So obviously, the bigger growers will pay much more to the association. The smaller growers will pay much less. Sometimes they can't even meet the cost of certification. But being members, by virtue of being members, they have access to that as a service and all the other services that come in the association. In terms of some of the standards being too exacting, yes, indeed. And this is why we feel very strongly that we do need global guidelines in how to deal with private standards. And for instance, some of the standards will go beyond what really you should expect of producers. For instance, one of the standards we have had to deal with is one that demands that exporters going into that market should educate all their workers' children. Now, I don't even think that even in Europe that happens. Yeah. We have, like I said, 100,000 workers. Each one of those workers will have some children, and we are expected to educate those to be able to enter certain markets. And that's just one of the real extreme ones. However, we also have some standards that look difficult. For instance, requirement to have baby creches on the farms. And eventually when we put some of those, some of them, the standards of some of them are so high that we now have a new problem of workers insisting on coming to work even when they should be at home resting because they're unwell. They want their children to benefit from that crochet, so they'll crawl to work. So that's just some of the repercussions. In terms of the post-harvest logistics, I think this is what it is. The industry here is pretty sophisticated, and the cool chain is one of the areas that is actually one of the reasons why the industry is so successful. Cool chain right from the farm all the way to the marketplace. And we even have service providers whose business it is to just monitor those temperatures right from the farm all the way through the aircraft, through the handlers in the marketplace, all the way to the final recipient. Their job is just to monitor those temperatures. So post-harvest is extremely important. The kind of nutrition that the flowers require, the way they are packed in the boxes and how the boxes are handled, all of that, we have a lot of service providers who have found jobs in that process. I like the issue of the branding, because this is where we're trying to get to. And before we could talk about a Kenyan brand of flowers, it was very important that we do the back office work, if you like, in terms of ensuring that we have a brand that we can stand by. And really the certification process or the accreditation process is our way of dealing with any interrogation of the brand Kenya, and also to make sure that the brand Kenya flower is truly Kenyan. So through the Kenyan, a new Kenyan standard, KS1758, which is now national and a requirement for export, we now have a brand or a tool to brand Kenyan flowers for the international market. So this is what we intend to use as a jumping, to jump off the board to put the Kenyan brand in the marketplace. And of course, we expect the branding to also take other elements, for instance, the source of the flowers, the environment where the flowers are grown, and that kind of thing.
Thank you, Jane. Carl, did you want to add anything on the mutual recognitions of standards comment that Jane made, that she thought there might be some support in the WTO discussion on that?
Okay. When we organized in Europe the internal market, we were not able to harmonize all our standards, but we started with mutual recognition as well. And you realize that when countries get together to agree on a common standard, this is also in many instances a tool to get market superiority. They want to impose their standard in order to secure markets, to secure portions of the market. In the WTO, we are discussing standards in the context of non-tariff trade barriers, and we have very concrete programs where we try to help people, producers of, I know examples of fruit and vegetable, to comply with standards. And in this context, we also engage standard providers with the idea to harmonize standards, but this is a very very cumbersome process. You can do some trimming at the edges, but in reality, it is very hard to harmonize standards.
Thank you very much. As I fear we have to wrap up now, since we have to vacate the room for the next group, I think we can review the enormously interesting range of issues that have come up. Clearly, standards are the biggest issue, both as an opportunity and as a challenge. As an opportunity to advance sustainability along several lines, to make sure that suppliers are properly remunerated, to distinguish in the marketplace, to provide benefits in terms of social benefits as well, but it's also a challenge to comply. It's a challenge to deal with the costs. That probably was the biggest aspect we discussed today. We talked about value chains and the different aspects and where things lie across the along the whole path. We talked about the rules of origin issue before you came, Jane, which is probably less precise in the flower business, but is an issue for many areas. And we talked about the role of the consumer and the private sector associations as a sort of impact sourcing model. I'd now like to ask our panel just one by one to give us a final 30-second takeaway message from this the session. Pierre, could we start with you, please?
Sure. So my take is very simply that the supply chain is complex, but to maybe lower the complexity of the supply chain, we have to engage more into dialogue between, let's say, the final supermarket, which is maybe at the top of the supply chain, down to the producer, to also avoid, and that was mentioned, I think, a couple of times, the mushrooming of standards, the conflict between the standards, that we get really rid of this and do not create, as businesses ourselves, the trade obstacles that we call the governments to remove. So I think that's clearly a message for me that I also will take home to my members and something that we'll have to investigate on further.
Thank you very much. Carl.
30 seconds. I very much hope that the Trade Facilitation Agreement will be to benefit of Kenya. You are delivering now to 50 countries. If trade facilitation is implemented, this should cut your costs, and I hope you reap the benefits. Thank you.
What I would be looking at is a voice in the marketplace, a voice where we can actually talk about our capabilities, enhanced and our enhanced capabilities to access the market. But I would also be looking to see that we provide opportunities for businesses in Africa, for businesses in the ACP countries to grow and to adopt these kind of tools that we have seen here today to promote trade between ourselves and the marketplace, all under the aegis of sustainable and inclusive businesses at the global level.
And I think overall we see in here the tremendous opportunities both within the trade policy system and within the growing collaboration between producers and consumers to advance development through the products and services provided in Africa, and specifically in flowers. Thank you to our distinguished panelists all. Thank you to the audience for great participation. Thank you.